How many of us actually know it's India where experiential learning actually blossomed in the gurukuls? So gurukuls were an absolute example of experiential learning, where everything was learned from experience, learning by doing. And it was not only about academic content, it was about value system. It was about physical development. It was about acquiring other skills. So today, if we're talking about art education, we're talking about music, we're talking about martial arts, sports. So all of it was done in India. So it's very important for us that we teach our children national pride, culture pride, and patriotism, in the sense that they should be proud of their mother tongue, their mother land, and all that it has to offer, and everything else that they learn globally. They have to be global citizens at the end of the day. So not only good citizens of the country, they have to be absolutely contributing global citizens. And it begins from the micro level of the classroom to the macro level. Even Mr. Toffler has says, the literate of the 21st century will not be the ones who have acquired degrees or are educated in schools and universities and have learned. They would be the ones who can learn, unlearn, and relearn. Now, that is so very relevant. And the entire policy actually revolves around that, because we know with the way technology is progressing, things are changing, the world is becoming more global, more one. We need to adapt. We need to adapt ourselves to all the new things that are happening. And for that, it begins in the school. I think most of us are aware of how the structure of the classrooms have changed. So it's the 5+3+3+4. 5 years is called the preparatory. So earlier, pre-schooling or pre-education was considered to be informal schooling. And now it becomes a part of the formal schooling. And they've added grades 1 and 2 also to that segment, which is the foundation. And why it has been done is because all of us are aware that the maximum development of the brain of the child happens, you know, around this age, by 6+, 7+, 85% of the brain has been developed. So the more exposure the child gets, the more they learn. And when I'm talking about learning, we're talking about, in any case, the policy emphasizes upon holistic, integrated, engaging, and enjoyable. All four factors are very, very important. Education has to be enjoyable. How many of us enjoyed ourselves at school? And wherever we enjoyed, or whatever subject or class we enjoyed, we excelled in that today. Whatever we did not enjoy, we hated even today. Irrespective of the fact that we may be having the potential, but it was not recognized because of various reasons. So we have to ensure that the child enjoys school, enjoys whatever is being given to them, and they're totally engaged. Again, you know, and personally, I always feel that, you know, whenever we are, especially in the classrooms, we should go back to our own school days and remember what not to do as a teacher. So if the class was not engaging enough, we were not involved in it, we would lose interest. And that's why many of us became shy, you know, or we did not like the subject, so on and so forth. It has to be holistic and it has to be integrated. We cannot have compartments, you know, a mathematics subject and a science subject and an English. All of it, learning happens together, because everything, all subjects, they are all interrelated. So in the foundation, a little child has to be exposed, you know, rather than giving them what to do, telling them what to do, making them learn by rote. We have to ensure that we give them, we know exactly what are the areas of development that are required here. So that would begin from the social skills, the physical development. The physical development would have both gross motor development, fine motor development, and very few of us realize that how important it is for the child to have the fine motor development. You know, it has a direct connection to the brain, how they think, how they're able to organize. It helps them develop various skills for later life. Then it has to be cognitive. So cognitive would include the literacy, the numeracy, you know, the thinking skills, the creative skills, performing arts, visual arts. So all these have to be covered, and they are, each one of them is equally important, and we have to realize the importance of each one of them. Then, of course, emotional development. And in today's scenario, when we talk so much about mental health and, you know, other issues, those emotional skills have to be developed right from the age of 3 when the child enters school.
I think it's important to really make sure that students are engaged and they are enjoying what they're doing. You made some very good points. Let me go over to Dr. Vasil next. And Dr. Vasil, I think one of the issues that we face in our school education system is that words such as holistic education and experiential learning, they are very easy to memorize and say and repeat, but they are very, very difficult to implement in schools. Now, you have obviously worked in an international school system where some of these things are actually work. Now, what would be your advice or what would be your outlook on how easy it's going to be for schools, for a school to actually transition from rote learning to a learning for understanding and for the teachers to start using experiential learning in the classroom? Could you share your views on that with us, please?
There are multiple issues connected with it. I was reflecting critically on the policy, while policy is aspirational, but it does not clearly give us assured direction on the implementing. Because when you talk about experiential learning, when you talk about collaborative learning, when you talk about frontline modern pedagogical interventions, it also calls for resource mobilization. It also calls for capacity building, skill sets. When experiential learning does not happen in vacuum, it is not a concept per se. It's a holistic engagement within the schools. If you have to deliver frontline curriculum in line with the 21st century skills, you have to honestly look at what are you going to do with the gap you have. So I think while it's aspirational, every educator must move forward, and it has to be a collaborative exercise. You know, the private school sector, which in a way has the ability and bandwidth to implement and execute some of these frontline initiatives, they also need to get into collaborative learning. Is inherently collaborative exercise. It is learning is inherently a relationship-based enterprise. So therefore, for this policy to be executed, we need to have a definite roadmap. We need to have very committed resources. For experiential learning to happen, it means connection with the larger life. Learning has to be connected to the life. At the center of this whole initiative is the skill sets of a teacher. What John Hattie said, you know, one of the great educators in his book called Visible Learning, one of the important tools for improvement is feedback. And we have never judiciously used this tool of feedback. We have only, you know, given some kind of prescriptive, you know, solutions to the problems. So it is that now is the time for progressive educators, for progressive schools to come forward and be part of this whole discussion process and identify the areas that how well we can execute and implement this new vision. Or what are the challenges or roadblocks we have? See, road to progress is always under construction. I think while this is an aspiration, I think we can take those incremental steps first. What Neil Postman says in his book called Learning as Subversive Activity, he said children enter school as a question mark, they leave as a full stop. And when it comes to experiential learning, you know, there are 5 important questions an experiential educator or facilitator will ask, did you notice? Why did this happen? Does this happen in life? Why does that happen? How can you use that? Critical thinking is, it should be the, you know, wherewithal, it should be at the heart of our learning engagement. So therefore, it weaves into many things. So we must recognize that at the heart of this, driving this initiative and making this change is the skill sets of the teacher.
What I've really, learned and what I've really picked up from what you've said is that private schools must collaborate with each other. I think that's a very strong point that Dr. Vasil has made. It's the age of collaboration. It's the age of cooperation. And if we really want to grow, we need to work together. And the second important message is that you really cannot, or you may find it very difficult to implement the policy if you do not train the teachers, if you don't empower the teachers. I think it's important for us to empower teachers with the right tools. And it's not the teacher's fault. I mean, I tell everybody this, that look, how can somebody who has never played golf teach somebody else to play golf? That's not never going to happen. If I have never played golf, I can't teach another person to play golf. Now, similarly, if our teachers have not, during their school years, if they have not experienced critical thinking, if they have not experienced critical thinking during their graduation or doing their BEd, and if they have not engaged in experiential learning, how do we expect them to train students to achieve that? So I think that is at the core of implementation for any private school, any school here, is that you must have a very serious plan to empower your teachers. You will have to invest in training your teachers. With that note, let me move on to Dr. Sharmishtha. There are two things that I would like you to share your views on. One is, how do we really develop critical thinking in students, and how important that is? And also, I would like to get your views on how best schools can integrate art in the education process.
Yes. We've been talking about critical thinking and how we can improve it in our school and educational system. And we are talking here about holistic, integrated, enjoyable and engaged learning. So what I would basically like to say is, you know, critical thinking is not really going to be some kind of magic or wonder that we will be able to fish out of our bags. It will really flow from the attractiveness of learning. If we can make learning attractive, as Nidhi Sirohi was also saying, that whatever we like to do, we always excelled in it. So I think that critical thinking will automatically flow if we make learning attractive, because, you know, when learning is attractive, it will make students relate better, and from there critical thinking will flow. I'd like to share a small anecdote. After I finished my graduation from the University of Chicago, I taught for 2 years at the University of Toronto, and there I was introducing undergraduate students to a capsule on modern India, a history course on modern India. And most of these students were, some were Canadians, but some others were Indians, but who were born and living in Canada all their lives. Their parents had come from India, and so they had very vague ideas about India. And I found after the first few classes that, they were not relating very well to the reading material. As part of the course, I had included films to be shown at the end, after the reading materials. It was a course on modern India. So I had topics like nationalism, communalism, Gandhi, etc. So I had a film which had to be shown at the end of the reading material. So what I did was I just turned it the other way around. I started the class with the film. So I showed, for instance, Richard Attenborough's Gandhi. Or, you show a film from that time, and I found the way students related or asked questions changed automatically. You know, they became more curious about that period, because, you know, it's removed by 50 years from when you are living. So I think, if we turn around our pedagogical tools a little bit, in the present education system, and I'm not talking about the film studies, film studies is something which prioritizes films, but, in the general mainstream schools, if you turn around your tools a little bit and you use the film or the piece of art to start with, I think it promotes better curiosity, better understanding to start off, because when you're relating to a piece of art, you are not only reading, you're listening, you're hearing, you're seeing, you're feeling. To feel about something is very important. And then, you ask better questions, you ask much better questions, and, that is what promotes critical learning. So, and when I was studying in the US, I had gone from here, from India, and I had a skill set which was very important. For instance, my writing was much better than the American students, but they asked better questions than me, and that was something I picked from them. So I think now that we are moving through the new education policy, that we are moving towards a more global, a more global skill set, we need to really, turn our skill sets around a little bit.
Thank you so much, Dr. Gupta, and I think totally agree with you. I think one of the one of the strongest ways of inculcating critical thinking is to first train students to ask questions. And I remember, you know, when I was teaching mathematics, I always used to tell my students that if you cannot ask, you know, five layers of why, W-H-Y, if you don't want to go deeper into a concept and keep on, and to do that, you have to keep asking, why is this relevant? Why is this important? Why does this work? I think if the students learn how to question well, how they learn how to put the right questions, their learning immediately starts and the thinking immediately starts. And culture could be one great way. I mean, showing a movie at the beginning of a class could be a great way to do that. Okay. Do we have Ruchi Rai here?
Yes, sir. Good evening. Don't you think that the private schools not only need to collaborate with each other, but if we start looking for some private schools which are already into experiential learning and start giving them that or creating them as nodal schools and start collaborating with the government schools also, then it will be helpful in solving this issue. Like the private schools, they can provide some of their expertise and help the government schools to implement NEP and experiential learning in a better way.
Let me go back to Dr. Vasil, and would you like to answer Ruchi's question, sir?
She was talking about experiential learning model, which some of the private schools are doing. Can government schools be engaged with it?
Absolutely.
The question is, who is going to audit them whether they are doing things right? Problem with the, sometimes we say these best practices to be followed. Who is going to audit the practices so that they can be cross-fertilized and use it in different geographical contexts, in different school environments? So we need to have some kind of accreditation and audit of these, you know, initiatives to ensure that it can be executed and implemented. Absolutely. And there has to be an authentic model of experiential learning. If private schools have to engage with the government schools in terms of know-how of taking NEP forward, we need to audit private schools in terms of their rigor on these new initiatives.
We have Madhu Sharma.
I would like to say that training teachers on questioning skills is very important. And I really believe with Dr. Vasil that quality is the key. Who monitors the quality of what is being done and how much is being shared?
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you for your comment. Let me bring in Mr. Mohan Pradeep Sharma.
Atul, basically I wish to make one remark so that, you know, the discussion become real interesting. It's a basically concept paper. It will not be fair to comment on the feet which are going to be attached after some time. So much better is that we talk about the conceptual changes which the government has proposed. It is very assuming that we look it from a very narrow angle and we start, speculating something which is not still come into being, which is very obvious also, you know, because the policy doesn't have its feet still. They are to be added by the state governments. And let us appreciate that this government has a will to, you know, address issues, gaps.
I fully agree with you, sir. I fully agree with you that this is just a vision paper. And I think we should limit, our discussion as if this was a vision paper. The implementation will happen next. Sir, let me just get Aruna Shivraj for 1 minute.
Sir, told, don't talk about what we can do. You have to think about what we can do. Sir, CBSE have introduced a hub of learning. That is one of the very good collaborative systems. But we were failed, sir. And already they have introduced a CCE patron. We have failed because the teachers are not trained, sir. So first, I request everyone, you have to take initiative to train the teachers. Then we can implement a new education policy. At the same time, we should start from Anganwadi system, not between the middle classes. We are facing lots of problems, sir. When the pandemic has started, we are facing a lot of problem taking this online classes. Teachers require the training.
I think you're absolutely right. And Dr. Vasil had also pointed, sir, it's very important to train the teachers. And in fact, we would definitely try to, make, and this is one of the Friday at 5 is one of the initiatives where we would like to expose and start talking about issues. And a lot of, we right now, in this session, we had about 500 participants. from across India who are participating, and a lot of them are teachers, and a lot of them are school leaders. So I think this is one of the initiatives. We will take more initiatives to train teachers. But at the same time, I think we need to look at this a little bit more positively, and do whatever we can do to implement the vision, as everybody said.